Buddy Baker leading the field. Cut a tire, spun the car, oncoming traffic, 39 cars at 200 miles per hour, 17 cars were destroyed. In fact, Kell Yarborough says he remembers driving his car beneath the somersaulting car of Bobby Allison. Why the multi-car crashes at Talladega? Well, Bill Elliott says when you have 20 cars just inches apart at 205 miles per hour, if someone makes a mistake or something happens, you're helpless. You're simply a passenger aboard this machine. He said, it's like I'm flying my airplane and the wings come off. I know I'm going to crash. There's nothing I can do about it. It's a really helpless feeling. For further stories about today, let's go up to my colleague, Dick Bergeron.
Jerry, this is the racetrack where the unexpected happens.
The crowd now begins to cheer as Bill Elliott and Bobby Allison come down through the 18 degrees of banking in the Trioval, looking for the green flag that will start this event. Let's watch him. If everything looks good, the green flag will go out. There it is, the acceleration. The pace picks up and the Winston 500 is underway. Side racing through turns number one and two. Bill Elliott has grabbed the lead. Bobby Allison, who started second, is dropping back quickly. Allison will lead them. Rather, Davey Allison will jump into second position and chase Bill Elliott down the backstretch. And here comes Sterling Marlin. Look at him move on the inside of the racetrack, passing Bobby Allison and going to third.
The world's biggest, longest, and fastest trophy dash, side by side, two, three, and four abreast around 2.66 miles of Talladega.
The first lap about to be completed. Bill Elliott will lead it, followed by Davey Allison. Then Sterling Marlin in third, running in fourth is Allison. Then Darrell Waltrip, Dale Earnhardt, and Terry Labonte as they head to number one again.
Boy, I must tell all of you, racing on TV is the best because you can get right inside the cockpit. You can see all the way around. You don't miss any of the action. But watching a race in person at Talladega, it's got to be a mind-boggling and a heart-hugging experience. It is tremendous.
Darrell Waltrip in the Tide Machine number 17 had a good qualifying effort. He's running fourth right now and may certainly be a contender in this event. The crowd is still cheering as the field comes down through the Trioval once again. They continue to run in the same order, though. It's going to be Bill Elliott leading Davey Allison. And then Bobby Allison, followed by Waltrip, Labonte, Lake Speed, and Jeff Bodine, then Dale Earnhardt. The pace is 209.82 miles an hour.
Much faster, I think, than anybody anticipated. 209 miles per hour. Automatically, right away, the strategy begins to unfold. Bill Elliott is making everybody, including Cale Yarborough, whom you're riding with right now, go faster than they wanted to do. Nobody really wanted to go 209 miles an hour.
We're inside Cale Yarborough's car. He's following Kyle Petty. Some of our in-car cameras as we watch Kyle Petty going to the inside of Ron Bouchard, you will hear the driver on and off the accelerator. Not here at Talladega, they're on it all the way around. And Petty moves around Ron Bouchard.
Ron Bouchard in Haas Ellington's Bullseye sponsored number one, running up there in the top 15. We might talk a little bit about some of the favorites, among which is not Cale Yarborough as far as today's race goes. A lot of people were looking toward Buddy Baker. Some people felt that Davey Allison had a real chance. Rusty Wallace was another name that was mentioned. And of course, Dale Earnhardt and Bill Elliott.
Here are the leaders. It's still Bill Elliott. And the Allisons are going for second position. The yellow flag is out. Yellow on the racetrack. We have a car smoking badly coming out of the corner number four. We'll be pulling into the pit area. And so this is going to be a slow lap.
Chet Phillips.
In the number 81 car, Chet Phillip has mechanical problems and brings out our first caution period of the afternoon.
Chet Phillip, the former Indianapolis car driver, he has qualified for two Indianapolis 500s, and of course he's racing out of the Buddy Arrington Potter Stables in 1987.
We completed four laps before we had our first caution period, but it's only for a mechanical problem and possible oil on the racetrack. The track crews will be checking it while we are under this yellow flag. Bill Elliott has led all the way. Running second is Davey Allison, and third.
jump by Phil Parsons. That may well be a judgment call. Phil Parsons is going to the lead. The green flags seem to be fluttering as Phil dropped down low, passed several cars, and now challenges Bill Elliott. He got around six cars as the green fluttered.
Now he begins to settle alongside Darrell Waltrip, and he doesn't have anybody to draft with, so he's backing up just a little bit. Now being passed by Dale Earnhardt as Dale goes to the high side of the racetrack, and already Phil Parsons has moved back to sixth position. So the lead continues to be held now by Bill Elliott, and Davey Allison second with Darrell Waltrip third, then Terry Labonte and Dale Earnhardt.
There is much talk these days about how the draft has changed, that you don't have that tornado-like draft that you used to have on these big racetracks, but there was an example right there that if nobody helps you, if nobody goes with you, and there are four or five cars that are basically against you as you're trying to make a pass, the draft does have an effect. Phil had the momentum going around turn one and two, but when he got on the backstretch, all the hot dogs stayed in line and said, sorry, Phil, we don't want you up here. Nobody let him in line, and they all passed out.
Well, the question in our mind was, did Phil Parsons jump the green flag? Did he begin passing cars before the green actually came out? The NASCAR officials say, no, he did not, so everything is okay with Phil Parsons. Well, out in front, a couple of Fords, Bill Elliott and Davey Allison. What are the drivers saying, Larry, about the possible advantage of the Fords here at Talladega?
Well, the drivers, all those without Fords, would like to say that Fords have a tremendous advantage. One of the more interesting quotes in regards to a response to that was Alan Kowicki saying, I don't think that a Ford helped me very much when I won my short track pole, but this is a big track. The drivers who don't have them say, yes, there is an advantage. I don't think the advantage is as much as it once was, say, the beginning of 1985 or throughout the 1985 season. Terry Labonte making a move, going underneath Darrell Waltrip. Those are two non-Fords. But I do believe on the super speedways, the Ford lines are just a tad better at this point. At this moment, could change in a month in the General Motors car.
Well, Terry Labonte is certainly showing some muscle here in the early going in this race. He started eighth and has already moved up to third position, as the battle for fourth now is between Bobby Allison and Darrell Waltrip, and Waltrip being followed closely by Dale Earnhardt, as the first three have pulled out to a few car lengths advantage.
If you're a Winston Cup regular, as we go back inside of Cale Yarborough's car, look at him following Rick Wilson on the left. Oh, coming very close to Rusty Wallace, and they stay together, but nobody panics. Everybody stays on a straight line, and no problem. That was, by the way, at about 205 miles an hour. Whew, I guess that's what you call confidence in your fellow man. I was about to say that if you've noticed, Waltrip is running up front. Yeah, he's had a good week.
Cale Yarborough is running in 17th, so the guys ahead of him are battling for 15th position, and Jeff Bodine has come in for an unscheduled pit stop.
Jeff Bodine, who seemingly had the race won at Martinsville on a very short track a week ago when he was involved in a very minor altercation with Kyle Petty. He said that he did not think it was either one of their faults. He lost that race, and he had great hopes for today. Dick Bergen is down there now.
Well, the hood is up on Jeff Bodine's car. This is not an easy situation, very obviously. One of the things that many of the mechanics are going to be watching here this afternoon, Bob and Larry, is the weather. The weather has been changing all day long. Most of the heat, most of the temperatures these guys have practiced at, qualified at, run at, have been in the 80s and the 90s. This morning, it was well into the 60s here. Now, that changes the way the cars run, changes the whole setup situation. So because they don't really know what it's supposed to do this afternoon, some of the forecasts say showers, some say nice, some say cool, some say warm, just about everybody has taken a conservative approach in setup. Right now, we're about to get some overcast. And meanwhile, up pit road is my colleague Jerry Punch.
Well, Jeff Bodine's car, the Levi Garrett Chevrolet, being pushed back to the garage area. The word, the engine came unglued in the car. He will exit here. They're going to try to take a little look at it back here and see if there's something they can possibly fix, but I think maybe the engine may be gone.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. 208.13 is the pace being set here in the Winston 500 as, again, we see the first three cars pulling away from the rest of the field. And those three are Bill Elliott, Davey Allison, and the Chevrolet of Terry Labonte.
Remember that Terry Labonte has a cracked shoulder blade. Now, it's come a long ways in the last 3 or 4 weeks, and in talking with Terry before this race began, we're looking at Davey Allison on the right, the leader Bill Elliott on the left. That's where he's been since the green flag dropped. Labonte said this will be a good racetrack to drive injured. And because the speeds are so high, you glide around. There's almost as much intellect that is involved as muscle running here at Talladega. And this is one of Terry Labonte's strongest performances. He really has not been in a position late in the race to win an event so far in 1987. A lot of people thought that he would be, and Labonte begins to make a move. He looks to the inside of Davey Allison. He glides past casually and easily, and Terry Labonte takes the runner-up spot as Jerry Punch has moved over and is ready to talk to Jeff Bodine.
Well, I'm disappointed that Jeff Bodine is still sitting inside the Chevrolet trying to get the cool suit off. Jeffrey, a short afternoon. What happened out there?
I don't even think it got started. I really don't know. Something went wrong in the engine. Act like a bearing was tightening up or something, but I tell you, the car was handling so good. Rick, I'm sorry, we're trying. We're going to get out of this bad luck streak someday, but it was running and handling so good. I really felt like we had a good chance at winning or finishing good here anyway, but I don't know what's wrong. We keep trying, working hard, running good, but we'll get it all together one of these days.
Well, Jeff Bodine referring to Rick Hendrick, his car owner, who's watching us on ESPN today. Bodine, the second car to exit here at Talladega.
Jeff, of course, one of our guests as we presented a special Speed Week last Friday night. He and Bill Elliott joined us, and Jeff had high hopes of doing well in this race, but unfortunately, it's over already for Jeff Bodine. But it's not over for about 39 other drivers, being led at this point by Bill Elliott, then Terry Labonte, and then Davey Allison. A new track record for attendance, 135,000 on hand here today for the Winston 500. Tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, Toronto, and we have a lead change here as Terry Labonte has passed Bill Elliott. So exciting hockey at 8 o'clock tonight here on ESPN. The Stanley Cup playoffs continue.
Bob, I think that may be the first time in 1987 that Terry Labonte has taken the lead under a green flag conditions. That's the first time any of us can remember, and Labonte is opening up distance between himself and Bill Elliott. Labonte has been moving up ever so slowly. It happens in most instances gradually here at Talladega. You can see his best 87 finish was a fourth earlier this year, but Terry Labonte, we thought that there were some concerned looks in the Junior Grant Johnson garage area, crew chief Jeff Hammond, throughout the week, but they have been a quiet but steady 210 runner all week long. And in the race, at least in the early stages here, Terry Labonte looks to be one of the strongest.
Back in the pack, meanwhile, one of the best battles going on right now is between Buddy Baker and Bobby Allison, as they are going for that fourth position. Bobby Allison has it, but Buddy Baker has been challenging him for several laps now, and you can see how Buddy is running that low line, just as he explained a little bit earlier to us. That's where he likes to be, because simply that's the fastest way around Talladega.
Baker has been the cream in recent laps, meaning he started in seventh about four laps ago, and he's been steadily rising. He just passed Dale Earnhardt about a lap ago. Bobby Allison is next up. Son Davey should be next. You can see Earnhardt, the yellow car, still in the picture. But Buddy Baker, who has a lot of sentiment, veteran observer, has one of the real
threats. Oh, we
Bobby
have a problem.
Allison is throwing the tire.
Bobby Allison with a horrible crash here on the front stretch. It has torn out a complete section of protective railing separating it. Alan Kowicki becomes involved.
Debris and is collecting other cars. There was a lot of debris in the front stretch. Kowicki was involved. Richard Petty, I think, is another one of the cars. Lots of debris on the front stretch. Now, Bobby's car, to me, appeared to stay together quite well. He did get up into the fencing, but not into the stands.
And it was close, though. He has torn out a whole large area of guardrail. There it is, protecting the crowd from the racetrack. And he came very, very close to going into the stands. The car became airborne and went flying literally into that wall and catch fencing. But fortunately, it did stay onto the racetrack. Bobby Allison is moving around in the race car, and that is certainly good news for us, but he has to be quite shaken after a tremendous crash. The red flag has been brought out, and quite frankly, Larry, I think we're going to have to be red for quite a while, because we cannot race with that protective fencing in the shape that it's in. It's just not safe for the spectators.
It's pretty obvious why it was there, happening right underneath Harold Kinder. It wasn't the fence that caught him, but they have built the cement wall here at Talladega just a little taller.
Bobby's out.
Racetrack. There's Bobby getting out of the car. I told you that Bobby's car, though, was heavily damaged. It didn't stay together. The integrity of the roll cage is intact. The crowd is giving Bobby a very warm welcome out of that machine, but the car lived up to NASCAR standards.
Larry, I think a tire blew. I think saw a tire coming apart while he was right here in the tri-oval nearing the starting line.
Right rear, it begins to shred, and the car goes out of control. You're at 210 miles an hour. You can see the right rear going. You see the debris there on the left-hand side of your screen. Earnhardt avoids Bobby. The car goes backwards. The aerodynamics get underneath the car, and Allison gets up into the fence. The aerodynamics lifted the car. They're not built to go backwards. Right underneath Harold Kinder. He stayed in there. Boy, I'll tell you, talk about a trooper. Kinder is right there. He's got the yellow flag out right away. That is a veteran, confident flagman. Here comes the rest of the field down. They've decelerated to maybe 180 miles an hour, but all the debris, there's Petty, there's Kawicki spinning. There's just nowhere for many of these drivers to go because there's so much of what was left over from the initial impact on the front stretch, and there was just nowhere to go.
And tires began to explode, too, as they ran over debris caused by the Allison crash. Well, it's very rare that you see that catch fencing do its job, but it sure did its job here at Talladega today. As if it hadn't been there, or if it had not been as strong as it was, Bobby Allison's car would very clearly have gone into the grandstand right below us here in the broadcast booth. There's the tire going.
Here's another angle of it, and we'll just let you watch it because we've covered it well.
There goes Darrell Waltrip going by without becoming involved in it. But as I said, as the cars came down now, they were running over the debris of the Allison car and tires were blowing. And therefore, they became involved in the crash. There's Petty, Alan Kulwicki, Phil Parsons, made contact with the Bobby Allison car. We understand that it's brand new catch fencing up here. And boy, we just salute the people here at Talladega for building it as strong as they did. There is a stretcher that we can see down there, a couple of stretchers, as a matter of fact, being lifted into the grandstand area. So perhaps there were some spectators that were hit by flying debris. All right, Phil Parsons did make contact with the Bobby Allison car. Let's go to Jerry Punch.
Well, Phil Parsons still sitting in the car on pit road. The back of the car is just about sheared away at that Copenhagen Oldsmobile, and Parsons talking to the crew chiefs. Apparently his day is over with. I don't think the car will be fixable. They're going to try to bring it behind the wall. Maybe we'll get a comment with Phil in just a moment and find out exactly what happened down there.
All right, so Phil gathering his thoughts, and you can see him sort of gesturing to his crew. I really don't know what happened, but I became involved. There, meanwhile, is the Bobby Allison car that has come to a rest between the start-finish line and turn number one. The ambulances are there. The track crews are there cleaning up the debris. Well, we will go inside now, Cale Yarborough's car, and see how it looked to him.
There he is following behind Greg Sachs of Valvoline number 50. The action is beginning to unfold. It's already unfolded up in front of him, and there's Cale trying to weave his way through all the pieces lying on the ground. You can see that Greg Sachs goes into a spin. Greg made a left turn, a right turn. There's Cale. He's trying to avoid Rusty Wallace. He goes sideways. He goes up, gets along the outer wall. I think he avoided significant contact. He brings it back around. It does a reverse spin as he is beginning to fight at the wheel. And now he can use the banking to coast down to the bottom of the racetrack, crank it to the right, try and get that thing to start back up again. The red light comes on indicating that the engine has been stalled, and then Cale Yarborough can get back around.
A scary moment for Cale Yarborough and a scary moment for many of these drivers who became involved in this Bobby Allison crash in the tri-oval. There is Richard Petty, who was also spinning, trying to avoid the cars that were in front of him.
A comment, by the way, about Phil Parsons, whose car does appear to be permanently damaged. He was one of the dark horse favorites. As many of you who follow Winston Cup racing know, many times a dark horse will win here at Talladega. And Davey Allison, Sterling Marlin, and Phil Parsons are three of the people who had not won here recently that were a definite threat for today.
Once again, a replay from the in-car camera of Cale Yarborough. This is at real speed. It'll be just as Cale saw it. Pretty much had it saved, but was hit a couple of times and then lost control.
Yeah, he got hit from behind. There's no question about that. You could hear it with the audio.
All right, let's go to Jerry Punch again and Phil Parsons.
Well, Phil's still sitting in the car on pit road trying to get the helmet unhooked. And Phil, what happened out there?
I have no idea. My spotter came on the radio and told me there's a big crash in the front stretch. So I was slowing way down right here in the tri-oval and got slowed down pretty good. I was waving my hand because I was in a bunch of traffic, and I probably slowed down to 70 or 80 miles an hour just picking my way through the debris, and somebody hit me from behind, I guess turned me around. I thought somebody else hit me then real hard, but that must have been when I hit Bobby. I heard somebody say that I hit Bobby after I got turned around, so I'm sure that's probably what it was.
Are you going to have to park it now?
I haven't looked at the car. I don't know. Not unless we absolutely have to. I'll assure you of that.
Well, Phil Parsons in the car. Now, take a look at the damage on the car as he climbs out. The car, the rear of the car completely collapsed back here, but the important safety feature, the fuel cell, is still intact. No fuel leaking from beneath that car, and the back of the car is completely shoved in. You see Phil getting out, surveying the damage here. Some of the sheet metal bent, battered. He is completely okay. The driver's compartment intact, but the fuel cell did save that. No fire, no fuel on the racetrack. A good safety feature here in Winston Cup competition.
Thank you, Jerry, for that report from Phil Parsons. Bobby Allison's car, meanwhile, has been loaded onto a flatbed and is being taken off the racetrack. And it's a very badly damaged Miller American Buick that Bobby Allison climbed out of, fortunately uninjured. But we're concerned about some spectators who may have been hit by flying debris. The track security and the Talladega Sheriff's Department is on the scene trying to keep the crowd under control as they assess the damage and possible injuries. That is the area of the crash, and it is just almost underneath Harold Kinder's starting area. Well, let's once again go down to the pit area for this report.
And I'm with Benny Gertel. He's team manager for Stavola Racing. Benny, you were close to that accident.
Yeah, I was up there spotting for Bobby, and when he comes through the tri-oval, the right rear tire blew, and that the air picked up the car and sent him right into the grandstands and ripped on portion of the fence. And then when he came back onto the track, spun around a few more times, and he said he was all right for now, and then here come Phil Parsons and hit him again in the door. Then I asked him how he was, and he still said he was all right, so that's racing, I guess.
How about the grandstand? Could you see, is everybody okay up there?
Everybody in the grandstand seemed to be okay from my vantage point, but I'm not really sure, Dick.
Well, that's good news. We certainly hope everybody is okay. Benny Gertel, he was real close to that thing. He said it almost got him.
All right, thank you, Dick. 22 laps have been completed here at Talladega out of 188. And that's kind of ironic because it was the number 22 car of Bobby Allison's that started this multi-car accident here on the tri-oval. There is Allison's car being taken back to the garage area on the flatbed. Well, a scary moment for all of us. We hope that everybody in the grandstand is okay. It appears as if all the drivers managed to escape this very bad crash okay here at Talladega. So we're going to take another commercial break. We are under a red flag condition at Talladega.
When you replace ordinary spark plugs with
the absolute contemporary style of fencing, the NASCAR people have been very conscious of putting the utmost to security and safety measures into the design of this racetrack. So it's likely that the old stuff, it might have been a little old, but it was pretty strong too.
The leader of the race is Terry Labonte. He's with Dirk Burgery.
Terry, you were certainly in the right place at that particular moment. First time you've led in the new car. Must feel good today.
Well, it really does. You know, all the guys really got the Budweiser Chevy running super today. It's really handling good. You know, of course, Elliot and some of the other guys are awful strong, but I really feel good about it. The car's working awful good.
People have been talking about the Fords here as Talladega as being the fastest. You're in a Chevrolet. Can a Chevrolet win today? Can you win today?
Well, I hope so.
Okay, that's Terry Labonte. He's in the lead. He's in the best position when the green flag flies again. Now down pit road to Jerry Punch.
Well, Bobby Allison just walked out of the infield care center. First of all, Bobby, are you okay?
I'm okay. Very thankful to the good Lord that I'm not hurt, and I hope nobody else down there is hurt too bad.
What happened down there?
I think I ran over something. I couldn't really tell. Something bounced under the car, and then the tire exploded. And I think I ran over something and cut my right rear tire down, and it spun the car in the tri-oval there, and up in the air it went, and round backwards, so just nothing I could do.
Any recollection of hitting the fence, or who might have hit you when you came down?
Well, I knew I hit the fence, and yeah, I recall that quite well. I don't know who else was involved, and I'm very disappointed anyone was involved. I'm very sorry about that.
Well, Bobby Allison, a true champion, even in defeat here at Talladega.
You know, the last couple of races, Larry, we have seen incidents of fans, if I can use that term loosely, throwing beer cans and other debris on the racetrack and really creating a serious situation. I think we have to compliment the fans here, because when that car hit and there was obvious pandemonium down there, most of the spectators kept their cool and rushed to the aid of their fellow spectators.
Yeah, most everybody who comes to Talladega is pretty serious and sit up in the main stands, because you have to make a major financial and emotional weekend commitment to come here. And those, for the most part, are pretty hardcore race fans. But you're absolutely right, Bob, that everybody remained in their seats. Everybody kind of stayed back to make certain that everything was under control as the situation unfolded. And really, nobody rushed down and crowded out the safety officials or the law enforcement people. There was no crowd control that was needed. You know, Bobby Allison had, for him, a very typical weekend again. On Friday night, he watched his son Clifford win at the Birmingham International Raceway, local by here. And he spent Friday night repairing Red Farmer's car. He raced himself last night, again on a night with a little sleep, and here at Talladega Sunday.
We had an ARCA Permatex 500-kilometer race here on this racetrack yesterday. ARCA competitors, and at the very beginning of that race, Jerry Churchill dropped to the bottom of the racetrack with a blown engine, and that was an indication, actually wasn't a blown engine, but a mechanical problem. And that was the first of many incidents that gave us concern in that ARCA race yesterday.
The ARCA drivers have shown marked improvement on the super speedways in recent years, but this race would not be without one major incident, which really wasn't the fault of any driver or group of drivers. It was similar to the situation we just saw here in the front stretch. There's Dave Fletcher on the inside and Rick Farmer on the outside.
And then a flip in the tri-oval as Billy Simmons' car got upside down, the number 17 machine. It landed in the entrance to the pit area, but fortunately, Billy Simmons climbed out of that car. It was a little bit dusty. In fact, it looked sort of like a chimney sweep after that accident, but he was completely uninjured and walked away from the crash.
Summer has come early to Alabama. There is Chargent Charlie Glotzbeck. Yes, the same one who once held the Alabama International Motor Speedway one-lap track record, the white car there on the low side. Chargent Charlie Glotzbeck has come out of Indiana, where he has been running dirt track cars the past three or four seasons. Says, gee, maybe I'd like to do this again. Has he lost anything? No. There he goes by Grant Adcox, who came into this race having won two in a row for ARCA here at Talladega.
And then a holocaust in the pit area. While trying to review the Bill Scott car, a fire broke out. And one of the crew members, whose name is Harry Rommel from Nashville, Tennessee, was burned rather extensively. He is suffering second and third degree burns. Third degree burns on 5% of his body. He's in the University of Alabama Burn Center, Caraway Methodist Hospital, and we wish him the best. Jeff Bodine saw this occurring and came down as a former volunteer fireman. He pretty much knew what to do, gathered a fire extinguisher, and started to extinguish the flames. That's Rommel being airlifted to the burn center as the race got underway once again.
A number of people appear to be candidates, certainly most notably Glotzbeck. Adcox is right in there. He was certainly a candidate. At this point, Glotzbeck had pitted before many of the other top contenders. We didn't know exactly why. Jeff Hammond told me later he was crewing that car, as a matter of fact, yesterday. He thought maybe they missed something. He didn't understand why everybody did not pit. There's Adcox making his move. And then as they came around turn number three, we've just had a restart. The field is tightly bunched. And then, watch this.
14 cars pile up, 10 of them unable to compete in the race any further. There you can see the melee down there in turn number four. A fire breaking out in the Tracy Reed car, but it extinguishes itself quickly. But there was a lot of damaged material down there. No driver injuries, however. Then the finish, Grant Adcox was able to pull away from Charlie Glotzbeck in the closing stages, and Grant Adcox won his third consecutive ARCA race here at Talladega, tying a record set by Davey Allison in ARCA competition and Buddy Baker in Winston Cup competition.
He did make it look easy.
The top five finishers in that race, Glotzbeck was second, Red Farmer was third, Bobby Wawak fourth, and Dave Fletcher finished in fifth position.
Might add that all five of those people had strong races. There was nobody in that group that backed into position. All of them looked like they were a threat to win.
Well, there is the cleanup going on down near the starting line as they're trying to repair the catch fencing, which will have to be repaired before we could start the race again.
The cars are lined up on pit road. And by the way, that ARCA race that we had the highlights from just a few minutes ago will be on ESPN at 2 o'clock Eastern Time on May the 23rd. It's an exciting race. We hope you'll be with us for that, May 23rd at 2 o'clock Eastern. Darrell Waltrip's car also was damaged slightly in that accident. Now, while we are red here, the crews cannot make any repairs to the car, so it'll have to go into the pit area after we resume this race to get repairs made.
What will happen is that we will not go back immediately to green. There will be, under these circumstances, perhaps as many as five, at least four, yellow flag laps. So most of the people who have repairs to do will be able to accomplish it during that yellow once we go back. But we are going to be down quite some time because serious, significant repairs have to be made to the wheel fence on the front stretch.
Again, though, the reason for
busiest of the 1987 season so far, and our line
on by Bobby Allison. Could you tell what was going on with the accident?
No, Bobby had started running a little bit higher than higher line than he had been running two or three laps before that. I just got up behind him and I passed him going into three. And as we come down the front straightaway, I looked in the mirror to see what, you know, where he was at, and all I could see was the bottom of his race car headed up towards the grandstand. And you know, you can tell it was going to be bad. I didn't look anymore because, well, you understand 200-mile-an-hour living. You don't watch everything. I knew he was in trouble, and we come back by. It sure made me feel good to see him standing outside the car.
Have you ever seen anything like that before?
Well, not that close. When I looked in the mirror, you know, usually you see a bunch of cars coming in the rearview mirror, and all I could see was exhaust pipes and a fuel cell and all up in the mirror, and then all of a sudden it started flipping.
Jerry Punch is with Darrell Waltrip.
Well, a fellow who had a front row seat for that, unfortunately, he's here to talk to me about it, Darrell Waltrip. Darrell, what did you see down there?
Well, we were coming through the trial here, and Bobby, looked like his tire went flat. It never did explode. It just looked like the tire went flat. And when the car set down on the right rear the way it did, the wheel dug into the track, and then the car went airborne. And from there, I saw it go. It appeared to go into the grandstand. I wasn't real sure. I went right underneath the front of the car, more or less, as he was up in the fence, and a big chunk of debris came off, hit the front of my car, knocked the windshield out, and when I opened my eyes, I was all right. I was going straight, so I was able to come on around, and then, of course, we pitted, and then they said they're going to stop a race, so we went back out, and now we're at the tail end of the field. We're going to have to put a windshield in, but praise the Lord, I'm safe and I'm sound, and I don't think anybody got hurt too badly. But I tell you, I've had a lot of race cars. I've never had one yet I could drive when the wheels were off the ground, and that's what happened to Bobby, and we've seen it happen several times this week.
Indeed, there are a lot of people on this pit area, on pit road, who are thankful that there were no serious injuries involved in that accident. Here's one of them, Darrell Walton.
Say hi to my mom and dad and everybody, mother and father-in-law, everybody in Franklin. Okay, I'm in the race, still got a chance.
We do not know at this point if there were any spectators that were injured. There were stretchers brought into the area, but they could be for minor injuries. We really don't know at this point. But the repair job does go on down here just at the starting line, and Dick Berggren has repositioned himself at the scene of this incident. Dick?
Yeah, Bob, and I've just talked to Don Naiman, who runs this racetrack, and the good news is no spectators have been seriously injured in this melee. Again, according to Naiman, the guy who runs this racetrack, his best information says no one is seriously injured. The fence, however, is going to need extensive work. They have welders down here, and as you can see, the fans are not at all deterred by this thing. They're anxious for the race to start, and so too are the officials of this racetrack. They want this thing to go on. They're working on the grandstand, fencing area. There is no damage at all to the grandstand. They just have to fix the fences, and they also have to fix some of the Speedway's sound system. They say about an hour. Jerry Punch, up pit road, has more.
Well, Dick, what I'm holding right here is a piece of Bobby Allison's Miller Buick, part of his race car. This piece is what Sterling Marlin carried back with him to pit road. This was in Sterling's car, stuck in the side of the car in that Piedmont Oldsmobile. There are pieces of Allison's car stuck in a number of these cars that's parked here on the start-finish line as that car literally disintegrated. And, Dick, to amplify a little bit on what you said about the injuries, I'm standing with Reverend Hal Marchman, who's the Speedway chaplain. Hal just came out of the infield care center, and we are thankful that the spectators who were up there was some of the debris up there, and Hal, everybody seems to be okay.
All of them have been discharged from the hospital except one with a laceration of the eye.
So there were four people in the spectators taken to the infield care center. They're all going to be fine. One small laceration, otherwise no significant injury. That's good news, Hal. Thanks for coming on with us. That's great news here. Everyone okay from that, what could have been a catastrophe down at the start-finish line.
Thank you, gentlemen. Yes, it could have been a catastrophe, and we are very thankful that there were no serious injuries. If you're just joining us, we ran 22 laps of the Winston 500 from Talladega, and then the trouble broke out. Bobby Allison in the red and white number 22 will shred a tire, and then the incident occurring.
Davey Allison and Buddy Baker directly in front. Earnhardt just barely gets by. That's Kenny Schrader on the inside of the racetrack. He slides by. Here comes Waltrip. He picks up that debris. You saw it hit the windshield right there. That was the only involvement that Darrell had. Now, there's lots of damaged parts strewn about the racetrack. We've got this slowed way down for you. You can see Allison's windshield sliding across into the grass and all kinds of debris on the racetrack. And the people coming up behind, you see that Greg Sachs went sliding by. There went Yarborough. They just had no opportunity to avoid.
Okay. Two spots in many Grand Prix and sometimes...
Petty is already into turn number two. Here comes Michael Waltrip out of the pits. He's also going to be doing the same thing. As for Phil Parsons, I'm not so sure that that car is going to be able to resume competition because it was pretty heavily damaged.
Now, what they are doing, they are keeping everybody on the same lap. Lake Speed, first in line, is being held up because in the confusion, Lake ended up being deposited in front of Terry Labonte. But as we have seen a couple of times, Lake is running in the top 10. That's why Lake, and we just went to the yellow flag. That's why Lake is being held up. He'll fall back in line in the ninth position.
For all practical purposes, 2 hours and 26 minutes of red. We are now under yellow. And the first couple of laps will be run under yellow so that everybody can come in and make an assessment of the damage or any needed repairs on their race cars, because in addition to a safe racetrack, we want safe race cars out there. Petty, meanwhile, is now coming into the pit area, as is Michael Waltrip, so they are back on the same lap with everybody else.
Now we anticipate Darrell Waltrip certainly to be one of the key players coming around. He'll be replacing that broken windshield. By the way, Bob, you saw that report from Jerry Punch a little earlier, and the name of the company that sends out the glass, the specialized glass for these Winston Cup stock cars, comes from Toledo, Ohio. It's famous for a couple of other things, the glass center of the world, and isn't that the home of a well-known automobile racing announcer?
No, I'm from Eastern Indiana. Why? Yeah,
glass center of the world, Toledo, Ohio. It's been that way for a long time. Libby Owens Ford, one of the prominent companies, and they supply the windshield for the Winston Cup cars.
Field on the backstretch, now entering turn number three. Under caution, Petty has made repairs and is pulling back out onto the racetrack. Michael Waltrip continuing to sit in the pit area as we watch the field under caution proceed through turns three and four.
In a situation like this, without question, the prudent thing to do is what NASCAR is doing, and that is to allow everybody an opportunity to come into the pit. This race will not go green until everybody has had a fair opportunity to make whatever changes or adjustments they need or wish to make at this point. Now, that is not to say they're going to delay this race if somebody takes 10 minutes, but a reasonable time would be up to 3 or 4 minutes, maybe the equivalent of 4 or 5 yellow flag laps. And I would not at all be surprised to see them wait and have everybody get out there and take 1 or 2 yellow laps before they actually drop the green flag. And Dick Bergen is down there with the latest update on what's happening.
And what's happening, Larry, is everybody is in the pits. Just about every race car here is, just about everybody here is in the pits right now. Labonte is in the process of a four-tire change. Right in front of him, Bill Elliott is in the process of a four-tire change. We're going to watch and see which one of those two guys gets out first, because whichever one it is, they will be able to pick up the lead. Down pit road, Jerry Punch.
Well, what you're watching is a high-speed windshield change. That's Jeff Chandler and Eddie Dickerson changing the windshield. Eddie Jones at the left front of the car. Right front of the car changing, working on some of that achievement damage. Elliott, the first car down pit road. Good pit stop for Elliott. Meanwhile, the windshield change continues here in the tight pit. They have the old windshield out. They are putting the new one in. Chandler and Dickerson, the two guys working on the windshield. The right front of the car has Eddie Jones working on some sheet metal damage. The tire was rubbing in the right front. Beneath the front of the car, the crew chief, Waddell Wilson, trying to clean up the air dam that's been bent. Three different teams working to try to make repairs on the Tide Chevrolet for Darrell Waltrip.
Most everybody else is roaring out of the pit area and falling in line. Darrell's repairs are still going on as the crew puts that duct tape after this one. Several cars still making pit stops and going back out onto the racetrack. Rusty Wallace has been in again. And the field comes through the trioval now. And when they cross the line, they'll be given the one more lap sign.
That's Kyle Petty right up ahead. This is coming off of turn number four. See the entrance to the pit there on the left. They are now approaching the trioval. There's the reverse shot of what you just saw from the track level inside of the Kodak machine. By the way, we lost two of our in-car radios in that massive crash. Bobby Allison and Cale Yarborough would have been assisting us in this broadcast today, but they were both knocked out, needless to say, in that crash as they exited the trioval.
Three cars were knocked out in the crash. Bobby Allison, also Cale Yarborough, and Ron Bouchard dropping out earlier, both with engine problems. The number 81 car of Chet Phillip and Jeff Bodine. But everybody else is still out there and about to resume competition. And there is Benny Parsons' machine.
Under normal circumstances, the moment of a pit stop here at Talladega is after about 30 or 31 laps. We obviously stopped on lap 22. Everybody came in on the equivalent of lap 23, so that just kind of moves the window for the pit stops up about six or seven laps, but everybody is, of course, on the same rhythm.
The official word from NASCAR, 2 hours, 38 minutes, 14 seconds worth of red. And there is the Alan Kulwicki crew doing some repairs to Alan's car. Let's get down to the pit area.
Moving down pit road now, gentlemen. They came in under the caution here for a lengthy stop. They had some sheet metal damage on the right front of the car. Apparently very minimal damage. They cut away some of the sheet metal so the tire would not rub. Alan gave them a high sign. Apparently everything repaired with his car. Hopefully he can go back to full speed competition.
And hopefully we can get some competition in here. We certainly don't want to see any more accidents like we saw yesterday and today. The Bobby Allison crash, a very frightening one, but no injuries to any drivers, and hopefully that the spectators are going to be okay. So get ready for the restart of the Winston 500 from Talladega. They were setting a pace well in excess of 208 miles an hour when the crash occurred, and we expect that to be the situation now as we are about to go back to green. The pace car pulls off the pit area, pulls into the pit area. Benny Parsons will lead them down toward a green flag. Richard Petty is right behind him. The crowd jumps up to its feet once again, raises their arms, begins to cheer, wave their hats, and here we go. The Winston 500 is green once again, and the race resumes. That's Bill Elliott dropping to the inside of Richard Petty. Bill looking for the lead. Here comes Davey Allison. Bill Elliott goes to the high side of Benny Parsons, and Labonte drops to the low side as they come off the second corner and go down the backstretch.
Labonte low being followed by Davey Allison, and there's Morgan Sheffrey. You see the draft effect taking place. And Davey trying to assist Terry Labonte to the lead. Moving up also on the bottom side is Buddy Baker. He told us earlier that's where he feels comfortable this weekend, and Baker is on the prowl.
28 laps about to be completed now. Terry Labonte is back in the lead with Elliott and Allison, second and third.
The last time through the trioval, I know it was the restart, but everybody was off the pace just a little bit. They really drove gentlemanly down through the trioval. Still a lot of dust from the quick dry that needed to be applied to the trioval section. By the way, Richard Petty dropped way back at the start of the restart of the race. You saw he didn't last very long up front. Petty has dropped back about 15 or 20 positions.
So they come out in the same order that they were running before the red flag, and Terry Labonte is looking very strong in that Budweiser Chevrolet. Elliott in second and Davey Allison is third. Here comes Buddy Baker in the Oldsmobile, who's also showing some strength. He was very confident going into the competition here this afternoon. Bill Elliott as they cross the stripe once again. Elliott going to the high side of Terry Labonte. Will he go into the lead? Yes, Bill Elliott is in front.
Bill Elliott, the man to beat on the super speedways for essentially the past 2.5 years. The performance dipped a little bit in 1986, but remember that great season back in 1985, 11 victories all on the big racetrack. There is the view out the back window of Rick Wilson's Kodak race car. You can see Benny Parsons right there. Everybody
falling in line, trying to find where their car feels most comfortable, despite the fact that this is a 200-mile-per-hour racetrack. There are two or three at least different lanes that everybody can choose to race in.
Look how fast the wall goes by you when you're running at 200-plus miles an hour. He ran through that area of oil dry and kicked up a little bit of dust, but there's no problem there. The track is completely safe, and no debris or oil is on the racetrack at this moment. Now we swing the camera around, and we'll get a shot from out front of Rick Wilson. He's running in ninth spot, by the way. Setting the car into 33 degrees of banking here in turns 3 and 4. Now they come on to the tri-oval where the banking is 18 degrees. Wilson trying the low groove. There he sets the car low into turn number one. Meanwhile, it's a four-car train. That's Bill Elliott, and look at this competition, back of the leaders.
By the way, Richard Petty almost a lap down. There you can see the bright orange Tide machine of Darrell Waltrip looking low. He's trying to get underneath Sterling Marlin. Rusty Wallace is in that group, also on the bottom. Alan Kowicki, who had major repairs, they tried to accomplish his pull behind the pit wall. Not out of it yet, but taking a long break here.
Look at this competition. That's 12th place Lake Speed in that purple car to the inside, and then everybody forming behind him. Benny Parsons alongside.
Ricky Reddick in that group. Rusty Wallace, Bobby Hillen Jr., Neil Bonnet.
Rusty Wallace is there in the Kodiak car.
Harry Gant is also in the end of that. Rudd not getting a good first turn that time, that red car. He's fourth in line as you look on the screen right now. The yellow flag is coming out. There is debris on the backstretch. Hopefully it's low as this pack of cars races into number three. Now remember, there is that gentleman's agreement, but they are all authorized to keep racing if they want to. And with this pack of cars and with everything at stake and as much money as they're involved here, see everybody plays it. They've all seemed to have calmed down. I see nobody making any sudden movement. There's Richard Petty, the red and blue car, a lap down.
Yeah, he would certainly like to get the lap back, but it's just impossible as the starters, the leaders, do cross the line under yellow. And speeds are reduced for the third time this afternoon. Neil Bonnet is coming in for a stop.
Neil Bonnet, who started this race in 21st position, he was the fastest of the second day qualifiers.
Let's go to Dick Bergman in the pit area, who's right there with Neil.
Well, now Bonnet has made another pit stop. He's got some problems with a vibration in the car. He made an earlier pit stop where they jacked up the right side, took a good look underneath it, the left side took a good look underneath it. Apparently his problems continue. Neil Bonnet, however, has now left the pit area.
They've had a pretty good year, Bob. They've been in or close to the top five in points all year long, and they've been racking up finishes.
Our third caution period of the afternoon, including one very lengthy red period, as Neil Bonnet catches up with the rest of the field. 33 laps are in the books. That's the...
They're still trying, as you said, seal the windshield area. The frame, as Larry Neuber mentioned, the frame around the windshield was what was bent, which makes it much more difficult than a routine windshield change. They have to come in and try to get as much sealing around the windshield. If air gets around that windshield, it will actually suck the windshield into the race car. They want to be very, very careful about that and try to seal it as well as possible.
Darrell moving back out onto the racetrack, however. We are under yellow because of debris that was spotted on the backstretch. The field is in the tri-oval and about to complete lap number 35.
Bob, one more comment about the windshields. They are safety glass. You saw a report from Jerry earlier in the pit. He was putting his hand right on what appeared to be shattered glass. Very soft, and it's not nearly as dangerous as what you drive around in your pleasure car.
Signal is being given to the field, and one more lap. We'll go back to green. It's Elliott. It is Terry Labonte, then Davey Allison, Buddy Baker, Dale Earnhardt, Ken Schrader, Kyle Petty, Rick Wilson, Morgan Shepherd, Benny Parsons, and Lake Speed.
If there has been a surprise, it has been the strength of Labonte. Buddy Baker and Ken Schrader have made the biggest moves inside the top 10. Baker right now is fourth, Schrader is sixth. Whether or not they can race up and do battle with the likes of Elliott, the current leader, Terry Labonte second, and Davey Allison remains to be seen. We'll see what happens here in the next couple of laps. Once again, moving into the top five, or at least as candidates for it, after having started outside of it. Buddy Baker and Ken Schrader doesn't really come as a surprise, even though Schrader has never won a race. Many observers were saying, hey, these two guys are strong. One other little wrinkle about that, Schrader and Baker have spent significant quiet time together. I don't know exactly what that means, but the last couple of days, they look like they are interested in at least assisting each other to get to the front. Let's see if there's any teamwork that goes on there. They apparently have been running together with each other in practice and feel very comfortable with one another. There is Ken Schrader, and who came out of the USAT open wheel rank, the sprint car and midget racer. You see, in eight starts, he's had one top five, four top ten, and he is the most recent man who looks like the biggest threat to pick up his first ever Winston Cup win.
He's moved from 15th rather to 6th. Richard Petty's car on the inside. He is a lap down. The pace beginning to pick up once again as the pace car pulls off, and a resumption of the Winston 500 is upon us once again. Richard is a lap down as Buddy Baker moves around him, and so will Dale Earnhardt.
This is where Bill Elliott shines. Needless to say, if you've been following stock car racing, or even if you've been living in a cave, you've probably heard about it. Bill Elliott does very well on these big racetracks. Daytona and Talladega have been his specialty. He is the one that everybody is pointing toward.
Well, our ESPN schedule has been certainly affected somewhat by the long red flag period. We're going to take this break and be right back with more from Alabama International.
All the right parts in all the right places. Napa's putting smiles on American faces.
Don't miss our biggest sale of the year. It's Car Care Days at your Napa Auto
Parts. We're in 38-minute red period when Bobby Allison went into the catch fencing and we had to repair it. The re-air on the Formula One San Marino Grand Prix Tuesday at 9 a.m., Friday, May 8th at 3 a.m., and Friday, May 15th at 1 p.m., all of those Eastern times. The top four finishers in that Formula One race today, Nigel Mansell the winner, Ayrton Senna was second, Michele Alboreto third, and Stefan Johansson finished fourth.
Bob,
here at Talladega, it's Bill Elliott leading Davey Allison.
Yep, and they pulled away a little bit, not substantially, but a little bit from Buddy Baker. Buddy may well be driving his own race. Right behind this trio is Ken Schrader, Dale Earnhardt, and Terry Labonte. Baker is the interesting character, in my mind, in this leading trio. You can see he's holding back just far enough that he's not in the picture. As we pull back, there you see him. He's now maybe 10 car lengths of speed behind him. Buddy Baker knows how to win at Talladega. Don't count this man out. He is hungry for victory. Look at him running right down there at the bottom of the racetrack. It's not necessary to do that, but if the car sticks down there, he doesn't abuse his machine as long as it runs carefully down there and smoothly. He's not abusing it quite as much as the other people. Up to the banking and also the quick way around. I suppose it gives you a touch better gas mileage. Yeah, that's not important. Not enough.
Now the Oldsmobile beginning to catch the two Fords who have taken off into the lead, Elliott and Davey Allison. They're running right together on the racetrack, and the Oldsmobile of Buddy Baker is beginning to catch up. But the two Ford products well into the lead right now here at the Winston 500.
This point in the race, not much strategy, not nearly as much as in the second half. You try to measure the leaders and find out what kind of pace they're running and make certain that you are at least capable of following along with the leader, whoever it might happen to be, and just keep pace with them. As you get to the second half of the race, you can start doing some more realistic experimentation. Where does the car run? Can I run up along the wall if I have to?
can I run way down there to bottom like I would like to, like you see Baker doing right now? You start picking the places where the aerodynamics, given the atmospheric conditions of the day, the velocity that you're going, the wind turbulence from the other cars, seems to work the best on your machine. What if I have to make a pass late in the race? That's when the real experimentation starts. There was a time when the drivers would do a lot of trading the early laps here at Talladega. Here comes Buddy Baker coming up to take a close-up view of the rear bumper of Davey Allison. But because the cars have changed so much in recent years, you can't afford to do quite as much jockeying as you once did.
Baker has now caught Davey Allison. Let's see if Buddy challenges for position. That last lap was at a 205.890 mile-an-hour race by Bill Elliott. Here he comes, leading the trio. Elliott, Allison, and Buddy Baker.
205, probably a little more realistic. The early laps when Bill Elliott was streaking away, remember he was going 209. Is it possible that Elliott can go 209? He's out of the throttle for just a bit and allowing everybody else to kind of be eased.
Back in fourth position is Dale Earnhardt, who is leading Ken Schrader and Harry Labonte. As you can see, some hand signal being exchanged out there on the backstretch. Dale taking that car also to the bottom of the racetrack as he tries to hold off the challenge of both Schrader and Labonte. Labonte going to the low side of Schrader and taking up that spot as Kyle Petty is watching.
What that four cars right there is trying to do, and what Dale was probably signaling for to Labonte and Schrader and Kyle Petty, he does not want the three leaders to get away even at this early stage of the race. Dale has been trading positions with Terry and with Kenny Schrader, and he is probably attempting to communicate to them, hey, the more that we race with each other, the further away those three leaders get, so let's stay in line. I don't know if Terry did exactly what Dale wanted to do in the last lap. Here comes Terry. Terry wants to go around Dale. Dale would have liked the four of them to stay in line and go up and catch the three leaders, but Terry says, hey, I think I'm the strongest car in this bunch. I may not need your help. I'm going to pass everybody. I'm going to go up and catch the three leaders on my own.
Well, that will look like an old-fashioned slingshot move, although the slingshot isn't nearly as effective as it used to be. But he sure used it going around Dale Earnhardt there at the end of the backstretch. And we're going to get a clock on Bill Elliott to see exactly the speed that he is turning here.
Bob, it's too early to be saying, well, so-and-so is in charge of this race. But if there are two people who have a little more say in what's going on right now and are in just a little more control, it would be, in my opinion, Elliott and Baker.
If you just joined us, we were 2 hours and 38 minutes in a red flag because of a Bobby Allison crash that tore down some fencing separating the grandstand from the racetrack, and we are back underway now, and we have run 46 laps of this race. We are timing the pace of leader Bill Elliott. Davey Allison is tucked in right behind him, and Buddy Baker is following in third. And there is the lap time of Bill Elliott. It is 46.2 seconds for 2.66 miles. That translates to a speed of 207 miles an hour. 207.28, as a matter of fact, for Bill Elliott. So he picked up a couple of miles an hour. And when we timed him on our stopwatches, just a few laps ago,
they have put a lap on last week's pole setter, Morgan Shepherd. Morgan Shepherd is now a lap down. Comment about Davey Allison. Continues to run in second spot. Had a long conversation with Joey Knuckles, his crew chief, yesterday, and they are very calm and collected. They don't sense any pressure at all. They just want to go out and do the best that they can, given the conditions for every race. No pressure to be rookie of the year, no pressure to go after points. They're really a pretty confident crew. They're constantly trying to give Davey some intellectual input as to how to approach these races. Joey Knuckles is a very experienced crew member, very experienced crew chief, and if anybody can help out a young man like Davey, Joey is certainly one of the people.
Well, Davey is certainly hanging right in there with Bill Elliott, not letting him get very far away. The pace of the race, as we saw, was about 207 miles an hour. We talked to Bill earlier about that.
You've had a lot of practice here, Bill, and a lot of laps, and the practice sessions are critical, but race pace. I mean, a lot of people are saying that the pace, because of the heat, may not be as quick as people want it to be early on. He qualified 212, but what do you race at it, and what kind of pace can we expect to see?
Well, I look at it in seconds-wise, probably between a 46.50 and a 47 flat. I don't base it in miles per hour. I just look at the stop goals, and then the fans can compute it into miles an hour. But from what I've seen race pace here before, it's been between a 46.50 and a 47 flat.
Can you imagine running a race with about 35 other cars out there on the racetrack at 207 miles an hour?
Either way, either in clock time or miles per hour, that is very rapid.
Let's put it
in perspective, Bob. 200 miles per hour. Almost everybody has been in a vehicle on the highway. There's Joe Ruttman, apparently. He is pulling behind pit wall. Joe, in a one-off ride at the ball number 99 for this weekend. Interesting to see whether or not Joe can come back out.
Joe is very enthusiastic going into this race also. Didn't qualify all that badly. Started 23rd in the race. As we are back inside the Rick Wilson car, the Kodak Racing Film Machine, and he is currently in eighth position. There you see Morgan Shepherd on the high side, but remember, Morgan has been lapped.
Again, put it into perspective. I want to drive that point home. 200 miles per hour. We're becoming almost casual about it, those of us who follow races, because it's commonplace in Indianapolis cars. It's commonplace on a big racetrack like Talladega here. And that's twice as fast as 100 miles an hour. And I know that almost sounds like a cliche. He puts one lap on Morgan Shepherd, obviously not running a car that's a full song. But think about it. 200 miles per hour.
You can see the tremendous difference in speed there as Rick just blew by Morgan Shepherd, who isn't running all that slow, although, as you said, the car isn't up to full capacity. Rick Wilson in turns number one and two again. Coming out onto the flat back stretch. That's Lake Speed in number 83, right behind Rick Wilson.
Rick Wilson likes this racetrack, Bob. He doesn't run every race on the trail, but he likes high-speed speedways, and here at Talladega, as well as at Daytona, Rick Wilson may someday soon win a race.
Davey Allison, once again, looks to be in a very strong, challenging position to Phil Elliott. He dropped to the low side of the racetrack, or at least looked low, going into turn number three, and now he does the same thing going into turn one, but Elliott hangs on to the lead, and Buddy Baker is also right there in third position, following Davey.
Remember, part of the legend of Talladega, dark horses winning, oftentimes the first win of their career. He is certainly not a dark horse right there. Buddy Baker, one of the acknowledged masters of Talladega. Still one of the acknowledged masters of Talladega. He may not run every race on the schedule, but when they line up and drop the green flag on a super speedway, Buddy Baker has got his act together. It doesn't make any difference if you won 5 of 7 or one of the last 50. You have to think in terms of, well, how do I beat Baker? He's always going to be one of the top five guys. Now, people who fit into that category of those who might be considered dark horses, maybe you don't think of them as wins, might be somebody like an Allison or maybe even a Sterling Marlin, but there are several others in the field.
Terry Labonte now is catching up to the lead draft, as he is within a few car lengths of Buddy Baker. Baker to the inside of Davey Allison. Let's see how this shakes out going into turn three. Both cars drop low on the racetrack, but Buddy stays back in third. But look at Terry Labonte, who's high on the racetrack in that number 11 Budweiser car. And now it's a four-car battle. You're right, Larry. When he went around that group of cars a while ago, I think he was telling them, I can run all by myself and I can catch this lead draft, and by golly, he has.
He proved it, Bob. I'll tell you, this is the best that Junior Johnson, the Jeff Hammond crew chief car, has looked throughout the entire 1987 season. There is Labonte looking at Buddy Baker. Labonte in the double-digit one and Baker in the double-digit eight. A couple of veterans now of NASCAR racing. Of course, Buddy Baker's been around for quite some time. And Terry Labonte, one of the new stars of the last decade.
Look at how close they are during drafting. That's Lake Speed in the Wins car right behind Rick Wilson, and some major league drafting going on here.
It helps both cars, remember. It's been pretty well documented by all the media that when you sneak up like that, both cars get just a little more horsepower as they power around the bank. It also helps the fuel mileage.
And the extra bracing you see there in their rear windshield is just simply to keep it from being damaged under these high speeds. It protects the windshield from being blown out when the car goes through air at over 200 miles an hour.
Now, what's going on right here is that Lake Speed and Rick Wilson have not been able to run with the leaders. But what they have discovered, particularly in the case of Lake, is that, gee, I'm running about the same pace as Rick Wilson is. I'm running faster than the back markers. They just went around Jimmy Means, but I can't run with the leaders.
So to help each of us, I'll draft for a little bit. Maybe it'll help both of us move up a little closer to the front, save just a little bit on the fuel mileage, and at least at this point in the race, that is the best move for both of us. That's my opinion, Lake Speed. Now, through hand signals, he may have transferred those thoughts also to Rick, and he agrees.
Just some great shots from Rick Wilson's Kodak race cam as we watch him and Lake Speed drafting. Look how Lake pulls right up on the rear bumper of that car going into the corner.
He has to pull back as they go through the banking because the turbulence has a tendency to move both cars around. It's not a safe maneuver to follow that close as they go to the banking. Down the straightaways, he can sneak back up again. He can get real close as they go into the corner right now. Now he's got to start thinking about getting out of the throttle. The car's going to tilt up as they go 35 degrees. Lake pulls back a little bit, gives both of them room. Now it begins to flatten out on the tri-oval, and Lake can creep up just a little bit more again.
And from the grandstand, that's how it looks. That's how far they are apart, or how close they are, perhaps we should say, as Wilson and Lake Speed are hooked up together in a draft. Crossing the start-finish line, that completes lap number 57. As the lead continues to be held by Bill Elliott, we're watching Rick Wilson and Lake Speed battle for that eighth spot.
Lake Speed had a pretty good qualifying run. He was the 10th fastest back up front. You see Davey Allison is still following Bill Elliott around. One of those two people is holding back. It's either Elliott or Allison, because it's very uncommon for two cars to stay this close for so long.
Despite the fact that it's 20 minutes of 6 Eastern time, we're still very early in this 188-lap, 500-mile race here at Talladega. The red flag caused a 2-hour and 38-minute delay. The red flag caused by Bobby Allison's spectacular crash here in the tri-oval, in which about 100 feet of catch fencing was torn down, protecting the grandstand, that had to be completely repaired. It is. Now we're back under racing, but only 58 laps have been completed. And the top three now have Bill Elliott, Davey Allison, Bonnie has now moved to third. Buddy Baker is in fourth position. We'll be back with the stretch. Now we saw Bill Elliott apparently run out of fuel. There is the catch can. Now Bill Elliott appeared to suffer a problem. It could be lack of fuel. Davey Allison, Terry Labonte, and Buddy Baker blasting around him as Bill Elliott went to the low side of the racetrack and into the pit area. Now Dale Earnhardt, who had come out of the pit area, but he was carrying his catch can. You can see it there on the back end of the car on the right side. He will lose that as the car went down the backstretch, and that has necessitated our fourth caution period of the afternoon.
A very uncommon occurrence for the Richard Childress crew for 1987. A mistake in the pits, and that hasn't happened very often. That may, as a matter of fact, have been the first.
And in any case, 61 laps now in, and the yellow out.
Earnhardt had pitted under green. He had lost significant ground. Bill Elliott had slowed down. He had lost a lot of racing ground. He apparently ran out of gas, as we told you, and as the leaders raced back to the line, the number 28 car of Davey Allison had the lead.
Let's go down to Jerry Punch, who's in the Davey Allison pit.
Well, Davey Allison breaks the half of these four down pit road. Joey Knuckles and the rest of the Peach Fuzz gang, they call it, because they're all fairly young fellas. They have the car fueled. They have changed right side tires. We'll move the deck around to the left side of the car. And Buddy Baker also getting on the bottom of the screen. Buddy getting tire changes as well. They have the four tires now going on the Davey Allison car. Baker's crew trying to get that car out. Allison's car down and off the deck. Baker's still working on his car, getting the tires changed on the Buddy Baker Crisco Oldsmobile.
Davey Allison pulls onto the racetrack, and now Buddy Baker begins to leave also.
Bob, but the big question is, did Elliott lose a lap or not? I think this caution flag saved him.
I think you're right. I don't think that Elliott went a lap down, but it was close.
Boy, what a break for Bill Elliott, because he lost at least a half a lap on the racetrack to the leaders when, again, we are speculating, he ran out of fuel. And just as that happened, Earnhardt made his pit stop. Earnhardt went out, lost the catch can. The yellow flag had to come out, and it allowed Bill Elliott to make up the half a lap deficit that he lost pitting as he coasted into the pit.
Richard Petty is also in the pits. Dale Inman and crew are doing some work on that car. Remember, that was one of the cars that suffered some damage in that Bobby Allison crash. But Richard pulling back out onto the racetrack.
Dick Bergeron, House, has also a report from the pit area.
Yeah, I just talked to Dan Elliott, and Dan said, no, they didn't run out of gas in Bill Elliott's automobile, but he did stall it here on pit road. Now, he came in under the green flag before that caution flew. While they were putting the fuel in and while they were changing the tires, the engine stalled. That's fairly common. It is also common that when the engine stalls, sometimes when they get it restarted, it sounds boggy. And when he left here, that engine sounded boggy. That appears to be the problem.
Well, Dick, he dropped low on the racetrack well before he would have if he was just coming in for a regular pit stop. So we may watch that situation and see if indeed Bill Elliott has trouble. Rick Wilson's crew finishing the job on his car, and Rick pulling back out onto the racetrack. We have been given a signal that there will be one more lap and then go back to green here at the Winston 500 from Talladega. 63 laps are on the board. Ken Schrader shown as the leader. Now NASCAR and an ESPN trackback. This trackback is brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. New Quaker State with QSX keeps your engine cleaner to last longer.
If you ever buy a brand new car, spend a lot of money for it, and get it home, and you don't exactly like the way the body panels fit. You know, there may be a little extra gap between the hood and the fender in order to please you. Things don't quite line up right. Spend all that money, but it just doesn't line up the way you might like it to line up. On the other hand, if you want to buy a car that's got body panels that fit perfectly, write yourself a check for $75,000 and buy a Miller American Buick like Bobby Allison is driving today. Look how nicely this hood fits. The door is all perfectly welded in, molded in, and formed in. And it takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of work to do all of this. And they do it for one reason and one reason alone: aerodynamics. And that's the whole ballgame here at Talladega.
Well, unfortunately, Bobby Allison's car does not look very aerodynamic now. He was the individual involved in a very spectacular crash here in the Tri-Oval on lap 22. We were down for 2 hours and 38 minutes to repair some fence. We are only 63 laps into this 188-lap event, and the green flag comes back out once again. The leader is Ken Schrader. Ricky Rudd moving alongside him, but Rudd is a lap down. Davey Allison there in the black and white and gold number 28 is in second, and Buddy Baker in the 88 car is third.
Schrader has given indications that he could be one of the stronger cars in the field, so now he has an opportunity. Davey Allison cuts right in behind him. They go underneath the 64 car. Connie Taylor driving for Elmo Langley this week. Buddy Baker follows through. Kyle Petty is the fourth one in line.
They come out of corner number four and into the Tri-Oval once again. Look at the field, all stacked up behind the leaders. As they come through, it is still Ken Schrader from Benton, Missouri, now showing the way. We've had eight lead changes among six drivers already. Back inside the Rick Wilson car now, the Kodak car. Benny Parsons there on the left side of the screen. Now he goes to the inside and passes Benny Parsons, and Neil Bonnet is also right in front of him. Benny obviously not happy with the car, with the way that car is performing. Benny Parsons out for a Sunday afternoon drive in excess of 200 miles an hour.
Tight quarters, two Valvoline cars, great fast. Neil Bonnet. There's Elliott moving up.
Elliott's car is apparently performing okay. We had some concern about that because he dropped low on the racetrack. And there is Darrell Walter, but number 17, now right alongside Rick Wilson.
Walter has been driving a calculated race since replacing that broken windshield. Remember, he ran up in the top four in the early season.
Darrell passes Rick Wilson. To the 33 degrees of banking once again. Connie Saylor, number 64, to the left. Darrell Walter ahead. And the lead now belongs to Davey Allison. Buddy Baker at second. Ken Schrader back to third. Bobby Hillen Jr. is running fourth. Remember, he's won his only Winston Cup race here on this racetrack.
Bobby Hillen Jr. was the best overall performer in the two races a year ago here at Talladega. He had a fourth in this race in the spring, and he won the midsummer race. first and fourth a year ago. Best performance of everybody.
Now Dale Earnhardt is also caught up to the lead wrap. He goes to the inside of Bobby Hillen Jr. and passes Bobby easily. Now he'll go outside of Ken Schrader. Is that Chevy handling well for Dale Earnhardt? He's fourth. But look at Terry Labonte and Kyle Petty also catch up to this lead wrap.
Baker, even though he has never won.
Look at the competition out there. Four abreast going into turn one. Unbelievable.
Passing lap traffic. Elliott leading the group. There's Sterling Marlin. He's in second of that group. Then comes Walter. Rick Wilson carrying our onboard camera. Benny Parsons out fast, and Dave Marcus on the high side of that group.
Marcus in the 71 Lifebuoy car. Car gets up high on the racetrack as Rick Wilson looks for a spot on the inside of the racetrack.
Back in 1976, Dave Marcus was one of the winners here at Talladega. One of the places where the...
Oh, an engine is blowing. It's Davey Allison. No, it's Buddy Baker. Buddy Baker's engine apparently has gone sour. A big puff of smoke and vapor from that car. Oh. And Buddy Baker's afternoon may be over. He's at the very high side of the racetrack in turns number one and two. There he is.
Trying to stay out of everybody's way. That was the best place for Buddy to go. Yeah, you might say, well, what if he's dropping oil? Isn't that dangerous? No, Buddy was right up on the top of the racetrack, and because of where he was positioned when the motor went away, that was his best move to move up there.
There he's signaling everybody behind him that he's going to the inside of the track, and Buddy Baker just with an unbelievable job of driving to keep that car high on the racetrack, out of the groove itself, and keeping everybody out of trouble. Back to the yellow they race, and it is Davey Allison now leading. Earnhardt is going to be second, Hillen third, followed by Terry Labonte, Ken Schrader, Kyle Petty, Bill Elliott, and Greg Sachs.
Now, for a lot of reasons, Bob, I'll tell you, I wish that Buddy would have had an opportunity to run this entire race. His last win was Daytona in 1983, and I felt he had a good chance today. There's Neil Bonnet. He takes this opportunity under yellow to stop quickly.
They're going to have to check the track for oil or other moisture on it before we go back to green situation. We're on lap number 70, and this is our fifth caution flag, caution period of the afternoon.
A year ago, Buddy's best finish in NASCAR Winston Cup racing was right here at the racetrack. We'll never know. You can see Allison getting way up into the wheel fence, bouncing right underneath Harold Kinder, spinning down the front stretch, the field bearing down on him. They're heavily on the brakes right now, but for some people, there just was not enough time to get stopped. Bobby is okay. There were no life-threatening type injuries up in the grandstand. A few anxious moments, but all of the necessary safety precautions that NASCAR insists upon really did their job here at Talladega today.
Well, we know that all of you who have been with us throughout the afternoon have seen that crash many times. We have replayed it, and we're doing it now because we're normally in our Formula One race time, but because of the lengthy yellow, where this race is being extended well into that. And that's why, for those of you who are just joining us, we showed you that Bobby Allison crash again. Again, no serious driver injuries in that spectacular accident right here at the start-finish line. And the catch fencing has been repaired, and it's a very good repair job that took over 2.5 hours, but it looks very fine as everything is well supported and the spectators are once again safe from spinning and crashing race cars. Let's hope we don't have any more of that this afternoon, but Buddy Baker was right when he said that problem developed on his car right where Bobby Allison did hit, and it sent a thrill through me as I saw that car in trouble, but everybody stayed out of the way, and everybody got through very nicely. The green flag comes out once again. Harold Kinder with it, and the Winston 500 back underway.
Bob, that last caution flag caught a lot of people at the wrong time. Suddenly, about four or five cars that were on the lead lap are now one lap down. There are the leaders. Davey Allison on the left. There's Bobby Hillen Jr. Sterling Marlin and Lake Speed, third and fourth in line, are a lap down. Two people who had hopes that, well, maybe our chances are outside ones, but we think we've got some.
Well, Bobby Hillen is sure looking good as he is in second position, and Terry Labonte there in the number 11 car is third. Here comes Rick Wilson, who is also a lap down. So several cars in this mix here, a lap down, including Sterling Marlin, Lake Speed, and Rick Wilson.
So Davey Allison finds himself in front of this snarling pack of 3,500 horsepower, 3,500 pound, I beg your pardon. It seems like 3,500 horsepower here at Talladega. And Davey Allison has some interesting decisions to make. You can see the advantage between first and second, and then second and the rest of the field. Davey has got to decide suddenly for himself, gee, how fast do I want to go?
Inside Rick Wilson's Kodak car once again. That's number 17, Darrell Waltrip right ahead, and the Wins car driven by Lake Speed, also ahead of Rick Wilson.
Waltrip has remained on the lead lap. Earnhardt out of the picture, but just behind you, also on the lead lap, and I'm pretty sure that number 9 car, he's also up there too. Be rest assured that Bill Elliott appears to be in control. There's Earnhardt.
There's Dale Earnhardt also passing Rick Wilson on the high side, going into turn number 1. There goes Greg Saxon, car number 50. So obviously, Rick Wilson's car is not up to full song, but look how those cars bounce around as they're in the 33 degrees of banking. Look at that, almost out of control.
An example of the buffeting we told you about. The cars appear to be out of control, but the drivers expect this, so they're ready to react whenever the wind gust just hits them the wrong way. They give just enough room between themselves and their fellow drivers, so when that car jumps around, they're able to catch it, save it, and no incident.
Let's go to Dick Berggren in the pit area for this comment. Dick?
Well, the leader, Danny Allison, is doing extremely well. He's on his own, but one of the guys who had been dicing with him, Ken Schrader, has now drifted to the back of the pack. The handle has gone away on Schrader's car. It has become loose. They just made 3 separate pit stops. They changed stagger, they changed the wedge, and they also changed the spoiler, trying to get the car back together again. They're looking for the handle on the number 90 car.
Well, that number 28 car of Davey Allison is really hooked up, and he too is working the low side of the racetrack. He's the leader at this moment with 77 laps completed. And coming around now in second position is going to be Terry Labonte.
Once again, stagger. There is Schrader. Dick was just talking about that. The stagger is the difference in the size, the circumference of the outside tires and the inside tires. Wedge refers to the ride height, basically, of the car on the four corners. And the spoiler speaks for itself. It's a little thin piece of metal that runs across the trunk lid, depending upon what angle you put it at. It either gives you more downforce or less and helps that car stick to the speedway.
Ken Schrader there on the inside of Ricky Rudd. Rudd is a lap down. The car ahead of this group, the number 27 car of Rusty Wallace, is on the lead lap, shown in the 11th position. There's Rusty in the number 27 car. That's Harry Gant, also there in 33. He is a lap down.
Close competition as always at Talladega. Although the lead changes, Corey, as it once did, but you can still see very good competition. Despite the ultra high speed to Talladega, the wind whips around this bowl of a racetrack and has a tendency to allow the otherwise slower cars to keep up with the otherwise quicker cars and makes for closer competition.
Neil Bonnett in number 75 is on the lead lap. He's in third position behind Terry Labonte. Look at the interval that has been opened up here by Davey Allison as that Haviland Ford is leaving everybody in the dust, at least for the moment. They enter the tri-oval once again. That's Dale Earnhardt, who has moved into fourth position behind Neil Bonnett and Terry Labonte. Bobby Hillen follows.
This is not the first time that Davey Allison has been behind the wheel of a machine in the 1987 season that showed to be a real candidate for the win. But as this race continues to unfold, as laps pass by, it's becoming his best chance.
Dick Berggren is with Joey Knuckles, who is the crew chief on the Davey Allison car.
Joey, you guys seem to be just taking off from the rest of the field. Aren't you concerned you might burn the car up too early?
Well, we were tight at the beginning of the race. The pace that we're setting right now is about the same as before Bill got stuck back there in traffic. Davey says he's really not running that hard, but, you know, maybe we'll talk to him in a little bit. He's a pretty upsy and gutsy guy, and he knows what's happening, so we're in real good shape. This Texaco Haviland Ford Thunderbird, we're going to the front and staying there, hopefully.
You mean that car has more muscle than you're showing now?
I can't say.
the crew chief and the driver were childhood buddies. They always went to the race together, and here they've got their chance.
Well, that was certainly going to be my question. If he has more left in that car at the pace he's setting right now, he has a handle on this field.
Bob, this is a big assignment for Joey, but based on what I've seen of this team so far in 1987, I'll bet they're pretty much in control. The assignment for Joey, and that is to not ride herd on Davey, but keep talking to Davey, keep giving him updates as to their progress in the race, where the rest of the field is. Keep in mind, Davey, this is a 500-mile race. We are going to go significantly more than 150 laps. That's Joey's job, to help keep this young driver informed so that Davey can concentrate on the lap-by-lap, turn-by-turn action out on the speedway.
Davey Allison's last lap was 207 miles an hour. Now Terry Labonte has broken away from third place and is beginning to reel in, although slowly, is virtually running away from the field at this moment, but we are still early in this race.
Bob, the lead stretched from 3.5 seconds to 4.1 seconds, and now it's up above 5 seconds. So Davey Allison is disappearing in the sunset.
You know, it's been our tradition here on ESPN to follow the good battles, and boy, Davey Allison is not in any battle whatsoever. He's running away from this field. Terry Labonte is in second position. The crew chief on this car, of course, Junior Johnson. Here's Jerry Punch.
Well, we're in the Budweiser pits with Junior Johnson, and Junior, Terry seems to be running pretty well out there. He's pretty pleased with the way the car is running right now.
Right now, Jerry, we feel like we're in real good shape. We just need to get back with Allison and Bill Eddy and stay there. We've been getting separated from them during pit stops, but to be here around the finish and be up there to have a shot at winning, we need to get back with that ball.
You got to be pretty impressed with young Davey Allison. It was you that gave him his big break here last year at the Talladega 500, and where a lot of people saw what he did by driving your car, substituting for Neil Bonnet.
Car here. We was pleased with him, and you know, if we helped him along, I'm glad of it. He's doing a real good job right now.
Well, they say Terry Labonte is back to 100% healthy now, so that looks like he's doing real well. In fact, the Budweiser team has been told already that Darrell Gwynn and Kenny Bernstein have already won in drag competition this weekend at Rockingham. They'd like to make it a clean sweep for Budweiser here in racing.
Well, right now, Terry has a bit of an assignment to catch Davey Allison, who has pulled away rather significantly. Now, here are some non-Winston Cup winners. Davey Allison started third, is running first. Sterling Marlin started seventh, is 12th. Bill Parsons dropped out of competition after being involved in the Bobby Allison crash. Lake Speed started 10th, is running 14th. Ken Schrader started 15th, is running 11th. Rick Wilson started 27th, is running 13th, and Alan Kulwicki has dropped out with mechanical problems. But those are seven drivers that have never won a Winston Cup race, but some of them that are still in contention here this afternoon.
And Schrader was the last one on the lead lap and the first one on the lead lap. I guess you'd say reasonably in contention is our leader, Davey Allison. He looks strong, and most importantly, he looks smooth. The lead is now stretched out, by the way, to 6.18 seconds.
Well, perhaps Davey was somewhat inspired when he saw his dad crash, the defending champion of this race, and Allison perhaps thought then, well, there's going to be an Allison in victory lane anyway, and it's going to be me. Once again, from the rear of the Kodak car, driven by Rick Wilson, that is Ken Schrader following.
And of course, the job for Schrader is to hold on as tenaciously as he possibly can to the lead lap. This is not a time for heroics for Ken Schrader. The machine is just not working. The chassis, the stagger they particularly have on the car right now, they're just not in harmony. So Kenny is trying to stay out there and hope that the pit stops come up or a brief yellow flag happens so he can duck back into the pit and stay on the lead lap and stay in contention for the win.
Schrader drops to the low side of the racetrack and now pulls right alongside Rick Wilson. Schrader right beside the Kodak car. Look at the work that the driver must do to maintain control at speeds in excess of 200.
Kenny Schrader, he certainly is one of the most versatile drivers in America today. He still likes getting in all types of equipment. Remember again that many of his early successes behind the wheel of a race car, he's giving a wave to Lake Speed. He's asking Lake to follow him. He waved to Lake.
And Lake did not drop in behind him. I think that they miscommunicated that.
Schrader almost ran into the back end of the car. Again, watching the action from Rick Wilson's machine. That's Lake Speed now right behind him. Ken Schrader is to the inside of the racetrack. And Rick Wilson is running in 13th. Lake Speed is 14th. So this is a battle for 13th spot. Lake Speed and Rick Wilson.
About this business of the hand signals between drivers when they're out there running around at 200 miles an hour, it's a very intriguing one because there are no hard and fast rules. And just because somebody waves at you, you might give him the acknowledgement. It doesn't mean that you are obligated to follow suit and do what it looks like it was indicated to be done. As you can see the situation right there, Lake Speed, as he darts down to the inside of Rick Wilson after trailing him for the last couple of laps. Does he have the advantage? Well, no, Rick is holding on. Oh, they get very close going through turn three and four. Just not enough momentum to get by that time.
Oh, we have a car spinning.
It looks like Harry Gant.
Car spinning is Harry Gant to the inside of the racetrack. Now he goes up into the banking and another car collides with him. Heavy contact with the wall in turn number four.
Looks like Ricky Rudd. The paint job looks like Bud Moore's number 15. There's Harry who started it. He was spinning down on the bottom of the track near the apron. He was racing with Ken Schrader. We could not tell from the angle whether or not there was contact between those two cars, but Harry Gant. The black one continues.
That is a badly damaged race car. Ricky Rudd coming in heavy contact with the wall. He was actually pinned against the wall by Harry Gant, whose car slid up the banking after spinning low on the track.
Ricky is moving around inside there, Bob. Signs look good here. He looks like he's trying to find a way to get out, looking for the connections on the window net. He drops the net down and now on buckling, and Ricky Rudd decides to wait it out until the safety crews get there. This is Harry's second accident of the year. He had a wreck also at Atlanta. And for Ricky Rudd, remember, he was involved very prominently in the accident that sidelined Terry Labonte, or threatened to sideline Terry, with the broken shoulder bone. This is the third accident that Ricky has been involved in this year, and those have not been his fault.
Sixth caution period of the afternoon, and once again, pit stops being made. Worked on Dale Earnhardt's car. They changed rubber on the right side, and now they're changing rubber on the driver's side of the car. And the crew wiping off the windshield. Quick pit stop for Dale Earnhardt. Out he goes once again.
Bob, I'll tell you, he has not dominated as we look at work being done in the Kyle Petty pit. He has not dominated like he has other races this year, but they are still very much in it.
There is Harry Gant, who's crawling out of that race car after he spun in turns number three and four and then hit the wall.
The apron breaks off reasonably suddenly. It's not a surefire thing that you're going to spin out if you drop down below it, but normally you are. Now remember, Harry's car is green and white. Let's see if we can pick it up on the screen. The spin has already begun. There is Schrader just jerking just a little bit to try and get around. And wow, right in Ricky Rudd's path. Ricky was just trying to make the only move that he could, and that was to squeeze between Harry and the track, or the outer retaining wall of the track, and there just wasn't enough room, and more importantly, not enough time.
Nowhere to go. Look at the impact. Tremendous. Ricky Rudd hitting the rear end of Harry Gant's car, then coming in contact with the wall, and badly damaged machinery, but no driver injuries, as Ricky Rudd and Harry Gant have both climbed out. And here's the shot that we had on the air. Harry is the third car in line. There he loses it.
I tell you, it was right directly in front of Ken Schrader, and it was not possible to tell from that angle whether or not there was contact, but the odds would indicate that there may well have been.
So Ricky is waving to the crowd.
This car is also the answer. Phil Parsons in 1983 survived a horrific first turn Talladega crash and rollover in this machine.
Bob, you see it developing right here. As they come down the front stretch, Phil begins the fishtail, makes contact with the number 11 machine, a Darrell Waltrip. Into the first turn they go. Phil's car gets airborne, and once...
Wallace. Yes, Wallace has the lead. That gives us our 13th lead change among nine drivers.
Both Wallace and Earnhardt lead for the first time today.
Look at this. Two abreast racing. Elliott, a little bit squirrely in turn number two. Settles down, though. Here they come down the backstretch. It's Earnhardt.
Who can push whom? The furthest, the farthest, the fastest.
Kyle
Petty also showing some muscle there behind all of this. There is Kyle on the low side of the racetrack, below lake speed.
Davey Allison encouraging Dale Earnhardt along, Bill Elliott pushing Rusty Wallace, and Cherry Labonte trying to pick a hole. Which lane is the fastest?
Oh, it was too close to call. I think Wallace will get credit for leading that lap also, but it was close with Earnhardt.
Rusty washes high.
Look at Elliott.
Earnhardt.
Elliott, low side, passes. Rusty, though, hanging right in there. Look at this great competition. Down the backstretch, Davey Allison is right on the back bumper of Bill Elliott. And now Allison goes for it on the low side. Look, oh, they almost touch. Unbelievable. Allison has the lead. Kyle Petty is coming on the low side.
Too good to talk about.
Boy, we got to settle down. We're still 68 laps away from the end of this race. Allison now begins to move away from the pack once again. I believe he is the dominant, the strong car, Larry.
He certainly appears to be, Bob. I tell you, on the last lap, it looked like that Elliott had designs of Davey following him through. I thought that wave was, you see Bill waving again this time to Kyle, saying, follow me through, we will get underneath Rusty to go in the corner. And the last time that Bill did that, Davey dropped down low and just ran off and hit.
The respect that you have to have for your fellow competitor running that close, that fast.
What an interesting, important moment for Davey Allison. I agree, Bob. I would have thought, in about 50 laps to go, I was thinking in my mind, I think that Elliott has got this race. I still stand by that because the experience really pays off, but in a crucial period in this race, one pit stop from the end, Davey Allison has shown everybody, and guess what, fellas? The number 28 car is going to run up front here, and to win this race, I'm the one you got to beat.
Elliott, Bobby Hillen, and Kyle Petty now beginning to form a group. Here comes Cherry Labonte to the inside of Dale Earnhardt at the end of the back stretch. And Cherry Labonte moves to third.
Remembering back to Daytona, yes, Bill Elliott won the race. Yes, it would seem like that Bill Elliott had dominated, but remember there was a man who led Bill and definitely had the faster car.
That win number one, Joey Knuckles as crew chief, headed for Winston Cup win number one. Bobby Allison had a brush with, well, fate. Yeah, it was really scary, his accident here in the Trioval about 20 laps into this race. The car airborne, going upside down in the catch fencing. The car never really going over, but the bottom part of the race car hit the catch fencing. It went back onto the racetrack, spun around several times, was hit by a couple of cars. Bobby Allison climbed out okay. A couple of spectators were injured with flying debris. They've been taken to a hospital, but hopefully no serious injuries to those spectators. It did cause a red flag for more than 2.5 hours.
Bob, Joey has been with the team for quite some time. He's had a lot of years of experience in races won with Cale Yarborough, but it is a big moment when you're the man in charge and you finally get your first win. Jerry is right now down in the pits with another update about the King.
Well, Richard Petty, overcome by fumes in the car. Earlier in that early lap accident, he had the cooler in the rear end come out of the car, and so they've been having trouble keeping grease in the rear end. They had fumes coming up in the car. He literally was overcome with it. You see, he's okay. It's getting a cold bottle, a little bit of oxygen there on the ground. They have put Greg Sachs in the car as Richard Petty now just getting some help from the paramedics and safety crews here at the Alabama International Motor Speedway.
Well, it's a warm and humid evening here in Alabama. And Eastern time is approaching 7:30. We still have 30 laps to go in this race. Allison completes lap number 159. By the way, Darrell Waltrip has been lapped in car number 17. There are now 9 cars on the lead lap. Let's go back down to the pit area.
Richard Petty sitting up now. Richard, paramedics have got some cold cloths on him. Trying to get Richard, are you all right? Are you okay, Richard?
Yeah, I got gassed up. What happened when we blew that tire after Bobby wrecked? Knocked all the inner panels out from under the rear end of it, and all the exhaust is coming up in the car. And I told Ellie, I wasn't tired, I was drunk. I couldn't tell where I was at, so I got dizzy. That's about my idea.
Well, that's what happens with carbon monoxide from beneath the car. You just simply go to sleep. And so he was getting sleepy. They got him out of the car with a safety move. And now they put Greg Sachs in the machine.
But the King still hangs in there after all of these years. And there is Greg Sachs in the Richard Petty car, as Davey Allison has gone underneath and put another lap on that machine.
Remember that Richard, there you see Richard's car, the old faithful number 43 with Greg Sachs now behind the wheel. Richard finished second at Bristol on another ESPN televised race earlier this year. Greg Sachs, the man originally from Matatuck, Long Island in New York, who had that surprise victory at the Firecracker 400 in July down at the Daytona 2 years ago, is substituting for Richard Petty.
This is Davey Allison's sixth Winston Cup race of the year. And his 13th career start. Let's go back down to Dick Bergren, who is with a very nervous individual, Dick.
Well, I am with Deborah Allison. Deborah, how do you feel at this moment?
Very nervous.
That's what they said on top. What are you thinking at this point? What's going through your mind?
I'm trying not to get too excited, but I just hope he can do it. I just hope he stays out front.
But you've been here before when your husband has won at Talladega. You've been here before when Davey has won at Talladega.
I was here when he won the ARCA race, but this is just great. I mean, this is just so much better.
Crash in turn two.
We've got a problem in turn two.
A car sliding to the bottom of the racetrack. I believe that's Ken Reagan, is it not?
Yeah, Kenny Reagan, number 77, did not see it develop. There was some claim as the car was coming down the banking. Apparently, it has snuffed out. Now, the interesting move here is, if there is a move by everybody, will everybody pit? Will people try to make last-minute adjustments in an effort to catch Davey Allison? Will Davey come in? Are they completely happy? Have they saved one set of tires? We have seen many, many Winston Cup races won at this very moment. One car is dominant, everybody pits late in the race, and somebody, usually one of the veteran crews, pulls a rabbit out of their hat.
Lap 164, and regardless of any adjustments in the pit area, it is going to bunch up the field. Davey Allison is going to have a rear view mirror full of Terry Labonte and Bobby Hillen Jr. and Kyle Petty and Dale Earnhardt.
25 laps to go. Looks like everybody is looking down low. They'll all be coming here to pit lane. Now, what if Davey Allison, Joey Knuckles and crew, are they not the first one out? Will he still have the oomph to get around everybody? Darrell Walter momentarily caught up behind him. He probably forgot for just a couple of seconds there that Davey pitted down near turn number four.
They're going to put new tires on the right side of the car. That car working very well, but Davey apparently thinks it can go faster there. Meanwhile, there's some work being done on the Terry Labonte Jr. Johnson car, as Labonte is on the bottom and Allison on the top of your screen. Now they're changing, rubber on both sides. Junior Johnson himself doing some work on the passenger side of the windshield on the Terry Labonte car. Davey Allison's work is completed. He goes back out there. Terry Labonte remaining, though, in the pit area. There he goes.
Excuse me, Bob. All of Joey's years full. Look at there. Earnhardt beats them out of the pit. They beat Hillen Jr. off. And Dale Earnhardt is the first one out of the pit. All of Joey Duffy
coming down for the green flag, and then 10 more laps to go. Earnhardt smashes the accelerator, and the pace picks up. The green is out.
Great start, Dave.
Allison right on the rear bumper of Dale Earnhardt as they go into one. Let's see when and if Davey makes a move. He's looking high in turns one and two. Earnhardt also drifts high. Off the second corner, down the flat back stretch of Talladega, Allison makes the move to the inside. He's got him. Allison goes into the lead.
Allison quick today or not. Now, all Davey's got to do, Rusty moving up to challenge Dale Earnhardt. All Davey's got to do, he's got the machine. Just get out front, Davey. Grab yourself about 10 car lengths and enjoy the racing behind you.
Nine laps
Bobby
to
Hillen
go.
Jr. Bobby Hillen Jr. is moving to third. Now he pressures Earnhardt for second.
Bobby Hillen Jr. running right alongside Terry Labonte. Okay, let's get an update on the condition of Ken Reagan, who crashed over in turn two, Nick.
Bob, I've just left the infield care center where they say he has a possible broken leg. Other than that, he is just fine. He is alert. He is talking to everybody. Possible broken leg, only extended in 3 and 10 minutes.
Terry Labonte moves into second position. Earnhardt back to third. But now Davey begins to open up the advantage just a little bit. That's Bob. Bobby Hillen Jr. in fourth.
Kyle Petty is another car on the lead lap. He's in double file right now. That's Kyle in the low side. You see the red on the hood. That's him trying to get around lap traffic. Lake Speed is in there. Lake's still running strong, but he's a lap down. Darrell Waltrip is right in there also. Darrell, one of the leading lap cars, but no chance to win.
There's the leader, Davey Allison. Second, Labonte. Third, Earnhardt. Fourth, Hillen. Fifth, Rusty Wallace.
Davey Allison, no doubt, calling on some of the experience that he gained in winning ARCA races on this racetrack. Takes that, well, you want to call it a Neil Bonnet line or a Grant Adcox line, down the back stretch, snaking down the back straightaway, making sure that nobody is gaining that unfair advantage, picking up on the wind that Davey is breaking. Davey is saying to everybody behind him, hey guys, do your own work. I'm out here all by myself. I'm trying to win this race. I don't want your help. I don't want to give any of mine to you.
Seven laps to go. 207.90, the pace set by Davey Allison as he leaves everybody in his trail. Has finished in the top 10 twice this year. He finished ninth at Rockingham and fifth at Atlanta. This could be his very first Winston Cup win. There's the battle for second. Four cars involved.
Allison, his best 85 finish, 10th here at Talladega. His best 86 finish, 7th here at Talladega. His best 87 finish, not determined yet.
Allison crosses the stripe. To go.
Attention begins to focus to the jockeying for second. What a terrific race this would be for the win if it weren't for Davey. Earnhardt does not have the strongest car in that group, but he is an outstanding motor racing driver. Dale Earnhardt is tremendous. He is carrying this car. Not that it's limited, but right now Wallace and Terry Labonte are faster, and it looks like Bobby Hillen Jr. is also faster. Remember, Bobby is so good on this racetrack. Earnhardt with the weaker car, but because of depth driving and picking just the right spots in the racetrack, he remains a potential for runner-up.
Earnhardt's streak may be ending here this afternoon. He's won four consecutive Winston Cup races. He's third right now and being challenged heavily by Bobby Hillen Jr. There are five laps to go around this 2.66-mile racetrack that has provided just about everything you could expect in auto racing for us this afternoon. And there's a great ARCA race that was run here yesterday that will be on ESPN May 23rd. We want to urge you to watch that race.
Earnhardt gesturing to Bobby Hillen Jr. behind him. Don't know exactly what it was. It did not look like, hey, come follow me. Not a Christmas St. Peter move.
2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 right here. They're all following Davey Allison. Here he comes through the tri-oval once again. There are four laps to go in the Winston 500. The crowd is cheering Davey Allison as he flashes by the start-finish line.
Terry Labonte, his best finish in 1987 so far, a man that many people felt would be the favorite to win this year's championship, has been a force so far this year. Traditionally, Terry has known how to finish up front in all the Winston Cup races. Traditionally, Kyle Petty going high. Traditionally, Junior Johnson high. Everybody thought he must have the inside track to the championship. They didn't count on Dale Earnhardt being bulletproof.
Earnhardt was a little squirrely, it appeared, up in turns 1 and 2 on the last lap around.
Carrying the car, Bob. I think that Dale is really working hard.
Three more laps to go. Allison still in command of this race. But a tremendous battle involving Terry Labonte, Dale Earnhardt, Bobby Hillen Jr., Kyle Petty, and Rusty Wallace for second through sixth position.
Now at this moment, everybody's second, third, fourth on back. They have to begin to position themselves.
Look at Kyle.
Kyle, I think, is doing just that. He made the same move on this lap that he made the last lap. But they all have to start calculating. Now, Terry hasn't given up on winning yet, but it's beginning to look a long ways away. There's Kyle going to the inside of Hillen. But each of them has to decide, where do I want to be on the last lap? Don't count out Rusty Wallace. He still definitely has a shot at the runner-up spot.
And now there are just two more laps to go. The interval between first and second is closing. Labonte is catching Davey Allison. Davey could have a contest for the lead, let alone second place.
I I sense that Davey is being extra special careful, Bob. He has a two-lap advantage. He can get out of the throttle by maybe a 16th of an inch. Yeah, that's probably stretching it, but Davey can cool it just a bit. Maybe this is a veteran-type move. This is an experienced-type move. Maybe. Let's see.
There you see Bobby Hillen and Rusty Wallace running side-by-side in turns 3 and 4 coming through. Here comes a white flag from Harold Kinder.
When he crosses the stripe, 2.66, 35 degrees, miles to go.
His wife, hoping that Davey can hang on for one more lap. And Joey Knuckles, the young crew chief on this car, may be winning his first Winston Cup event ever.
No conversation. Joey's just looking down, checking the stopwatch, checking the chart. He's making sure they've done everything right. Anything to keep your mind off of the emotion. Davey Allison, a half a lap to go.
Let's watch and see if Davey Allison can win the Winston 500. He's in turns 3 and 4. He's on to the tri-oval, a short straightaway connecting turn 4 and the dog leg here in front of the grandstand. He's a few feet away from the checkered flag. There it is! Davey Allison wins! Terry Labonte finishes second. And Dale Earnhardt finished fourth. He was passed by the number 21 car of Kyle Petty as they came down. So Kyle Petty picks up third and Earnhardt drops to fourth. Then Bobby Hillen Jr. and Rusty Wallace.
The sweetest victories are the first time winners.
What is it about Talladega that produces these first time winners?
The high sign from Dale Earnhardt. He leaned out the window and gave the okay sign to Davey. He said, young man, you drove yourself one heck of a race.
There's Joey Knuckles receiving the congratulations from the people in the pits. And the spectators are cheering Davey Allison as he has his hand in the air.
Davey Allison has had a shot at a couple of other races this year. He's had a couple of crashes that he's had to survive. He's been fast every time out. They opened everybody's eyes when they debuted with a rookie driver at Daytona. They qualified on the front row. He has a pole already in 1987, and now he has a win.
Here's what it looked like. Rainfall amounts, though, were less than an inch in Kentuckiana this evening. However, flooding occurred over many area streets. The 1/2 to 3/4 of an inch of rain that did fall fell in only 20 minutes, and that caused the water to collect over low spots, including what you see there, the I-65 exit in Jeffersonville. Fortunately, though, the heaviest rain for the